If it was in a vacuum and I was like, for the purposes of me listening to it, enjoying it more, I would re-record the entire thing, to be honest. Yeah, what do you have to say for yourself? Whoa. Whoa. I mean, it was such a formative process. It was my first time in the studio, but then also it happened to be a very charged, one of those sort of epic studio experiences that you sort of hear on VH1. And I had a producer who was on the same page as me and encouraging all those elements in me in the best way possible. A very loyal, steadfast, talented drummer. So everyone was very much in the zone, and we all did most of it in the producer's apartment. There were no actual amps or anything used on the record. It was all like the pod, whatever they had at that time. We did drums in another studio, but anyway, most of it was spent kind of holed up in this apartment for like several months in Brooklyn, where I had never really spent time. And this was before Brooklyn kind of became, you know, and it inspired a lot of the ideas behind it and the song Admit It and stuff like that. But it was just a very specific set of circumstances, us just kind of losing our minds, me more than the rest of them.
And the record begins with a song of rebellion.
What we were originally going to do was have it be like a full-on musical. So that's why, one of the reasons why Stephen Trask co-produced the record, because he had done Hedwig, and we wanted it to have spoken word interludes. Like, it was really going to be an oral experience, so like with sort of like War of the Worlds or something like that, where you could like listen through and know exactly what's happening. But we just found it was taking too much time, and we were on an indie budget. But there was, you know, I was writing a script with a couple friends of mine as we were doing it. The songs were arranged in a specific order, which remains on the record. But the concept that would have been the story was very much so connected to my life and still had so much to do with the experience and then later my like kind of mental illness stuff that was going on. It was very meta. It all connected. That did kind of fall by the wayside, the fact that it would have been more than just a collection of songs.
Smell California in sweet hypocrisy.
It was, again, the thing about everyone had the same, was sick of the same stuff in my group of friends, like music critics and the people we were playing with. Everyone knew that it was us seeing through this sort of scene cliche. And I think that was encouraged. It was one of those things that was really encouraged and that like people were like, take it further. Whoa, not dead yet. What do you have to say for yourself? Whoa, whoa. The chorus I like definitely like feel connected to every night. And it just feels like so like, it used to feel like a crazy thing that I was saying this stuff, and now it just feels like, yep. Like, I don't mean that in like a mundane, like it's not fun to sing it. It just means like, this is life. Like, this has been my life and our everyone's lives for the past fucking 18 years. You know what I mean? So it's like, this is reality. This is how people are, and it sucks. You know?
I self-medicate with drugs and alcohol to treat my extreme social anxiety. You are a faker. You are a fraud.
A lot of the people in the audience are a lot like me, I feel like. And we've had that kind of fan base from the beginning, even when it was like a younger fan base. Like, they reminded me of like younger versions of myself.
I can't stop thinking about what she did wrong to me. Can't figure out just what I did wrong.
Every Man Has a Molly was written in the studio, and you know, just like, how much further can I take this third person stuff? Like, let's do it to the point where that's the entire song is just about me being on stage and wanting to get paid.
You goddamn kids had best be gracious with the much money you spend. God's for you.
It's hard for me to back things without making fun of them. I have a really dark sense of humor, and like, I feel like the funniest thing you could do is break up a moment of like really something dark and call it out at the time. Anyone who takes themselves too seriously, especially as an artist, is
maybe missing out a little bit on something because it was so perfect for emo, because emo was already like, I'm crying, like I'm dying, and it's like, and it's funny, you know, like yeah. And may, like bring up some more uncomfortable things, like I haven't showered, you know what I mean? Like, if we're gonna go there, let's get real, you know?
When I watch you, wanna do you right where you're standing, yeah.
It was just a really raw, emotional song that I wrote. I had like a crush on a girl at the time, and then I went to go see like The Pianist in the theater, and it made me brought up memories of the Holocaust, which I grew up with. My grandparents were all their lost their whole families in the Holocaust and were there, and it's a primal fear of mine and represents kind of what it does in that in that song, Nazis. Being like oppression and sort of the world around us being cruel and dark and people trying to stop you from feeling how you feel or being how you be, you know, sometimes with the threat of death, you know. So to have feelings for this person that I was having and knowing that there was probably something that was gonna go wrong, but it wouldn't really be our faults because like the world's so messed up that it would probably come in and try to stop us from being together, was kind of what made me write that, kind of be like, screw that, I'm gonna like still love you despite how bad the world is. And the Holocaust was the ultimate, like, where I imagine someone trying to pull off just like, you know, under the worst circumstances, being in love.
If you could forgive me for being so brash.
It was my only thing, you know what I mean? It was my only job, it was my only art, and I was alone, I was single at the time, you know, I was like, it was all I had. So everything went into those songs, you know what I mean? It was consciously not just therapy, it was like everything I could put out, I put it into this record. I'm a big believer in like the butterfly effect and all these things. So when there's something on the record that actually drives me fucking insane, I think it's terrible, it may have made me do something better on the next record. You know what I mean? So I wouldn't change anything. If it was in a vacuum and I was like, for the purposes of me listening to it, enjoying it more, I would re-record the entire thing, to be honest, because I can't take my voice. I would use real amps. I would, you know, there are things that I was obsessed with as a recording process, like that I wouldn't do now that at the time were like the most important things to me, recording wise, like laboriously comping each vocal take on every like syllable, and which is cool. Like actually we did a little bit of that on our new record, which hasn't come out yet, but not me being the one to go in there and be like, oh, I hate that syllable. Oh, I hate that. And like, leave it, let the producer do it a little bit. So there's a lot of those things that I would change and a lot of things I would do to protect my mental health, like shorter hours or having a place with people I know and, you know, not doing it in Brooklyn.
Watch my yellow cat invade my red cat in the yard. The feline war has raged for years, so I assume it'd be too hard.
I mean, like, everything in my life has led up to everything in my life. All the most terrible things and great things have led to where I am at right now. And since I live a sort of no regret type life, and I'm really happy with my life and I've got, you know, beautiful children, beautiful wife, it's like, why would I wanna put me on a different path, you know? There's always something that I would do differently now. In retrospect, I'm happy with, I'm very proud of what it is.
Who will love me so good they won't hear a screw away the day I'll make you say